Shalom, brothers, sisters. Once again, you're not under the sounds of the voice of your brother, Taza Dark Shah. What I wanted to talk to you about is how one can remove IRS tax liens by levy. This is a very imperative subject. It is not intended to be legal advice, nor do I offer legal advice. If you need legal advice, seek yourself a competent counsel and then please be advised. Now, there's many of you, you say you watch my channel for years. You haven't donated anything. You've learned, you've gotten remedy from it. If you've applied it appropriately, yet you continue to take and you never get back. Then there's those that have actually donated for the cause, and you appreciate it. But to the leeches that actually continue to take and state that freedom is free, then why aren't you free? Nothing in this world is free. My time and energy is of great value. To those of you that irrationally think that I'm going to sit down and construct hours upon hours of documents for you, and you not make the required donation to become a secured party, then you are far beyond deranged. Now, I just wanted to get that out of the way. Now, to those that sincerely would like to get themselves up out from under the system and become a secured party creditor and perhaps even a sovereign, click the email link below, get in contact with me, and your process will be done correctly. Stop trying to take shortcuts. Stop trying to take these methods that a few Moors have actually tried to mix in with the free man movement and telling you to register the birth certificate that's actually already been registered by the de facto state. Stop the madness, folks. So, if you find this video to be of value after watching this video in its entirety, at least 4 to 10 times, to have it embedded into your subconscious mind so that you could naturally respond appropriately, then you click the PayPal link below the video and donate whatever value that you may find it to be worth. Be that $200, $300, you have the means, $1,000, $50, $10, whatever value you may find it to be worth. If you need personal coaching, click the email link below and someone will be in contact with you as promptly as possible. You can reach me on one of, learn from one of my several channels, the Deprogram Enlightener on YouTube. You could type in the Mighty Sovereign. It's going to bring me up on YouTube. Or you could tune into the newer channel, the Undaunted National on YouTube. You could tune into your best body ever on YouTube. Those are just a few channels that I actually have, depending on what your interest may be. So with that being said, this video, this very informative video, is how to remove an IRS lien, a levy. Now, how much do you think information like this would be worth? Because you're not going to learn this in your public venues. Now, 26 U.S.C. 7432, civil damages for failure to release lien says, in A, in general, if an officer or employee of the Internal Revenue Service knowingly or by reason of negligence fails to release a lien under Section 6325 on property of the taxpayer, such taxpayer may bring a civil action for damages against the United States in a district court of the United States. crystal clear. 26 U.S.C. 6325, release of lien or discharge of property. Section A says, release of lien subject to such regulations as the security, as the secretary may prescribe, the secretary shall issue a certificate of release of any lien imposed with respect to any internal revenue tax not later than 30 days after the day of which liability satisfied or unenforceable. The secretary finds that the liability for the amount assessed together with all intent in respect thereof has been fully satisfied as has become legally unenforceable. So, brothers and sisters, the regulations that the secretary has prescribed are 26 CFR 301.6325-1, release of lien or discharge of property. Section A, a release of lien, liability satisfied or unenforceable. Any district director may issue a certificate of release of a lien imposed with respect to any internal revenue tax whenever he finds that the entire liability for the tax has become unenforceable as a matter of law and not merely uncollectible or unenforceable as a matter of fact. So, brothers, sisters, in the case in Re Usum number 87-2189, 9th Circuit, 1988, a United States bankruptcy appellate panel held that, and I quote, there are clearly other methods that a liability might become legally unenforceable. So, when we look in a Treasury Inspector General for Tax Administration memorandum, two Deputy Inspector Generals for audit stated, and again, I quote, so don't believe me. I'm giving you where these things are located. Don't believe Tyler Dock. As I always tell you, go and check it out for yourself. CFF staff are not always filing liens in accordance with the Internal Revenue Service Manual, IRM, guidelines and are interpreting national policies in a variety of ways. End of quote. End of quote. So, also, they said, and I quote, the IRS should develop a more uniform lien filing policy that would be that would better protect the government's interests. End of quote. So, brothers, sisters, I interpret that to mean, and I would think that you would also, that the IRS is making mistakes throughout their lien filing process. You just need the knowledge to recognize what those mistakes are, enabling you to get your lien removed. Do you understand? And again, this is not legal advice, nor is it intended as legal advice. Now also, include in, you know, this report by the Treasury Inspector General reviewing IRS compliance with the statutory lien process, this report actually tells you right where to look for the issue that will render your lien legally unenforceable, which states that, and I quote, again, the IRS did not completely comply with the law. So, respecting the lien process. Now, this report states that the IRS did not mail the lien notices timely as required by the Internal Revenue Code 95% of the time. 95% of the time, the IRS is not compliant with its own manual rules. So in addition, they found instances where the IRS could not provide proof of timely mailing. So the report notes that the IRS had made changes, but that those changes showed no improvement in mail lien notices more timely. So what does this mean, Tajadar? Well, this means that there is a technical defect in more than 95% of the liens that have been placed since the Reform and Restoration Act of 1998. The Treasury Inspector General acknowledged this in the report by saying in his recommendations, and again, I'm quoting this Treasury Inspector General report. We, and I quote, recommend the director consult with the Office of Chief Counsel to identify any actions necessary to correct the potential legal violations we identified in this audit. End of quote. So brothers and sisters, you could get a copy of that report. Now, in this information that I read, I also read a section of the code that imposes the 5-day notice requirement. Now, a federal appellate court made it clear that to get your lien removed under 26 U.S.C. 7432, you must first go through the requirements of 26 U.S.C. 6325, when it said Section 7432 amounts to a limited waiver of sovereign immunity for civil damages actions for failure to release a federal tax lien upon notice under IRC 6325. Plaintiff has not shown that he has given notice in accordance with 6325. End of quote. Overton versus the United States, 925 F2D 1282, 10th Circuit, 1991. So we are supposed to learn from Mr. Overton's mistakes, folks, and give notice in accordance with 6325 before taking any other actions, Mr. IRS. So you need to write a letter for entertainment purposes, for informational purposes, for educational purposes, to the area director, who used to be called the district director, by the way, utilizing both 26 U.S.C. 6325, 26 CFR 401.6325-1, and 26 CFR 301.6325, and prove that the lien on your property is legally unenforceable. Now, to write an effective letter, you might first need information from the IRS. And you will get that information with the right knowledge. Now, if you cannot see what makes the lien legally unenforceable on the face of the lien, then send these FOIAs, get back the responses, review 26 U.S.C. 6325 and 26 CFR 301-6325 that are actually not that difficult to access, folks. Also, for entertainment purposes, also review 26 CFR 401-6325 1F to be sure that your request for a certificate of release with respect to a notice of a federal tax lien includes everything that is required to do so. Plus, review 23 published cases respecting this statute or the 51 pages of note that someone took from these cases, plus some others that actually have been actually included by other folks. When you write your letter, 6325 letter. Now, brothers and sisters, I've learned by reviewing case law that when there is no sign assessment, there is no liability. Since the lien statute states or starts out, if any person liable to pay any tax neglects or refuses to pay the same after demand, end of quote. So, brothers and sisters, get your minds right. Get your minds right. If there is no signed assessment, there is no liability. If there's no liability, then there can be no lien. Do you see my reasoning? Do you understand? Do you understand? Do you overstand? Do you understand? Excuse me. So, I, Tazadok Shah, am of the opinion that this will not work unless your letter sounds like you know what you are doing. Many of you, you don't really know what you're doing. You go online, you read a few documents, and you try and get remedy in something, but you don't totally comprehend. Right? Fully explain to anyone that's trying to become a SPC, a secured party creditor, make certain that you understand this. The only way to do that is to sit and read all the cases, statutes, and regulations that are part of what you're doing. So it is vitally important that each man or woman do this, because when the letter reaches the area director's office, he's already going to know which arguments are valid and which ones are not valid. Do you understand? The area director or district director, whatever you want to call him, is not going to declare your lien legally unenforceable unless your letter is creditable. So this is the reason I keep checking the case law and try to stay current. He's going to know what the courts have done most recently and should. We also not know. He's going to know what the courts has done most recently, and so should we then. So if your letter contains arguments that are not valid, it will not be creditable, nor will it be effective. Sometimes people have me review their letters. Hey, I don't offer legal advice. I'm just a facilitator. I'm just an aggrieved man. Here to help you avoid mistakes that you may otherwise make on your own, and perhaps coach you to write more effective letters and documents if you so choose to emulate mine, with more authoritative. So brothers and sisters, you send a letter in and you wait for your response. If the area director denies your demand letter to remove your lien, it is not proof that your issue are not valid. You simply move on to the next step. So you have complied with what is known in law as condition precedent. Condition precedent, should I say. So, if you do or if you don't do first things first, you will not get your expected results. And then, next step, for educational purposes, after you've gotten a negative response, if you get a negative response to your demand that the IRS remove the lien, you may be asking, well, tie the dot, what do I do next? Well, I spent a lot of hours over several months, a couple years, finding the answer to that very question. And I reviewed a lot of cases over that time and eventually came across some cases where the judge explained the remedy. 26 U.S.C. 7432. So in summary, the taxpayer's Bill of Rights waived the United States sovereignty, immunity, and made it possible to sue for their refusal to remove legally unenforceable liens because of the filing of them without following the procedures such as FOIAs will expose 26 CFR 301-7432-1 requires that. In Section E, no civil action in federal district court prior to filing an administrative claim. 26 U.S.C. 7432-D provides that. Limitations. One, requirement that the administrative remedies be exhausted. A judgment for damage shall not be awarded under Section B unless the court determines that the plaintiff has exhausted the administrative remedies available to such plaintiff within the Internal Revenue Service. Now, can you see what they are doing, folks? They want you to send in your administrative letter and give them an opportunity to prevent you from suing them. So, what would what you would hope that means and what is likely to occur is that the lien would be removed without you ever having to go to court. 26 CFR 301-7432 requires that you send your letter to the Chief of Special Operation Functions in the District Director's Office. See, I checked it out. I checked this regulation on, 3 months ago? So, as of that particular date, the regulation still read the district director and chief of special operation function. See, this guy has the ability, based on a well-worded letter complying with the statutes and regulations, to call off the dogs, so to speak. So, what the heck? He can even award you damages if your letter is good enough. That's right. So, anyway, now there is somebody that will actually read your correspondence that has the power to do something other than file it. So, my first letter, based on 7432's sister status, 7433, which works on almost exactly the same process as 7432, calls the IRS to withdraw one levy and not to execute on a second that they had threatened upon me. See, I had a friend that used this same process mentioned in passing that at the sending in his letter, his next Social Security check was for the full amount. And, of course, if you haven't guessed it already, those letters both threatened to sue. So, who could ever imagine that curtailing IRS collection activity could be as simple as sending a well-worded authoritative letter to the person that has the power and authority to stop illegal tax collection activity. And the Treasury Inspector General for Tax Administration memorandum linked to the information that I read. The two deputy inspector generals for audit state, and I quote, "With its current process, the IRS does not have enough resources to resolve all the balance due accounts in its inventory to deal with this year. Years ago, the IRS created the queue to hold cases for future assignments to review officers who make personal contracts with taxpayers. The collections potential of each delinquent account is prioritized by computer as high, medium, or low risk based on case type, amount, and skills required to work the case." Do you understand? Do you understand? So accounting meets certain criteria are immediately assigned to revenue officers, while others are assigned from the queue to revenue officers as workload permits. So based on their assignment priority. Now, not only is the IRS in this situation, so is the U.S. Attorney's Office. It is this oval bearing workload on both to their part that works in your favor when using this process. They don't want any more lawsuit, folks. I'm not suggesting you go out and do a lawsuit. I'm just educating. This concept makes it very strong and likely that you will win while you are exhausting your administrative remedies. So, brothers and sisters, I found a section of the code that states the secretary may withdraw a notice of lien filed under the section, and this chapter shall be applied as if the withdrawn notice had not been filed. So if the secretary determines that the filing of such notice was not in accordance with the administrative procedures of the secretary. Now, I know this sounds exactly like what I, you know, I might have mentioned in another video, you know, but brothers and sisters, this may be your remedy. This may give you another shot. So based on one lien that I recently examined, the IRS may be not sending the due process notices timely, but may be putting dates on the notices that make it appear that they were sent timely. You see, I read a case describing how the certified mail records are maintained and processed by the post office and the IRS. And a copy of that case can be found. Now, from that case, I learned exactly what the postal form to ask for in your information for freedom. Do you understand? Do you understand? So it occurred to me that there was probably a regulation that went with the section code that imposed the 5-day requirement. I didn't have to search too long, and I found it down in the question and answer the section of regulation, and I found this question and answer. So wherein the commissioner actually excuses himself from the compliance with the statute and regulation. And I think the Treasury Inspector General disagrees with this position, calling it failure to send the notice timely potential legally violation. So the answer continues, therefore, the failure to notify the taxpayer concerning the filing of a notice of federal tax lien does not affect the validity or priority of the notice of the federal tax lien. So when the IRS determines that it failed properly to provide a taxpayer with a collection due process notice, it will promptly provide the taxpayer with a substitute collection due process notice and provide the taxpayer with an opportunity to request a collection due process hearing. It is at this hearing, folks, if you elect to, that you will kick their asses or set up issues for judicial review. And remember, in 1821, the U.S. Supreme Court says in Thatcher versus Power that no public officer can take any actions affecting your property unless authorized to do so by express law. And that person invested with such a power must pursue with precision the course prescribed by law, or his act is invalid. So, I mean, you could read the direction in its entirety. So, if you notice them, that they fell to timely send you a collections due process notice required by statute, they may send you a new notice and give you an opportunity to schedule a hearing. So it is in my opinion, folks, that you want to go to that. You know, I overheard one person saying, when it comes to fighting the IRS, Dr. Robert Clarkson said, the former attorney tells somebody over the phone in his South Carolina drawer respecting a collection due process hearing, well, keep him tied up for years. My position on that would be, if he can, so can you. So can you. And another reason I say that this is that you will have an opportunity to expose them in such a manner that the issue is preserved for review by the courts. And I've learned that there is a form to request the hearing. There's a form to request the hearing. So on that form, you must tell them what issue you intend to raise at the hearing. And brothers and sisters, this very well may be your remedy. This very well may be your remedy. So there are probably many unpublished wins that will never be heard about out there that were taken care of administratively. So if you would like your letter to carry some weight and to succeed, the chief of special operation must find your letter, somewhat threatening for educational purposes, to sue the informed and very credible. So the way you can accomplish this is by studying. I'm not giving you legal advice. I'm giving you right knowledge. And don't believe anything that I tell you in this video. As I always state, go and check it out for yourself. Research everything. Don't believe anything that I or anyone tell you. Research it for yourself, brothers and sisters. So with that, I'm going to bring this to a close, and I trust that you gained something from this video. And if you like the video, take a few seconds and like the video. If you need personal coaching, click the email link below and someone will be in contact with you as promptly as possible. If you would like to become a secured party, click the email link below. Someone will be in contact with you as promptly as possible. And if you found this video to be of value, click the PayPal link below the video and donate whatever value you may find this video to be worth. And with that, share the video, subscribe to the channel, share it with your friends and family, as many people that you may think that could actually benefit from this video. Once again, Tazadok, signing out. I'm going to say shalom.